Over the churning waters of the Pacific in 1944, a new kind of warfare was unfolding. Armed with cutting-edge technology, the U.S. Navy unleashed its secret weapon, the Interstate TDR, a fleet of unmanned drones, each a harbinger of destruction. These mechanical birds of prey, laden with explosives, soared towards their target. The first drone dove with lethal precision, striking the enemy ship's midsection. The impact was catastrophic, unleashing a massive explosion that ripped through the sea air. Smoke and debris mushroomed into the sky, marking the ferocity of the strike. The second drone narrowly missed its mark, veering past the ship's superstructure and crashing into the ocean's depths. The third, with its payload primed, zeroed in on the ship's bow. In a tense moment of near success, it fell agonizingly short, skimming past the target without detonation. Then came the fourth drone, the final shot. It found its target near the ship's vulnerable rear, detonating with a thunderous roar. The explosion tore through the hull, engulfing the vessel in a raging inferno. This operation marked a monumental victory for the U.S. Navy, heralding the dawn of a new era in remote-controlled warfare. The Interstate TDR had not just struck a blow against an enemy ship, it had opened a new chapter in the history of aerial unmanned systems. As early as the 1920s, the use of radio-controlled target ships showcased the possibility of remotely operating vessels. It was a tantalizing glimpse into the future of warfare. But it wasn't until 1936 that the United States Navy began the quest. Their initial aim was to develop unmanned aerial systems to serve as targets for naval anti-air gunnery practice. Lieutenant Commander Delmar S. Farney proposed the audacious idea of employing unpiloted, remotely controlled aircraft in combat operations. However, the technology of the era proved limiting, relegating the assault drone project to a back burner. Yet, the invention of radar altimeters and television, coupled with advancements in gyro stabilization and radio technology, breathed new life into the concept of unmanned aerial vehicles designed for specific missions. With the world embroiled in World War II, the United States government's willingness to invest in unconventional ideas grew. In 1942, the nation sought to develop cost-effective, user-friendly drones to safeguard its invaluable human crews. While the end of the war seemed distant, the potential of this experimental technology couldn't be ignored, especially in the Pacific theater against the Empire of Japan. Yet, amidst the urgency of acquiring proven conventional weapons, the Navy's new drones, birthed as part of Project Option, needed to be both economical and constructed from materials not in high demand for the war effort. After converting manned aircraft into experimental drones in April 1942, the first operational test of a drone against a naval target was conducted. The trials of the Naval Aircraft Factory TDN assault drone paved the way for Interstate Aircraft to secure a Navy contract. They were tasked with crafting two prototypes and a staggering 100 production aircraft, all under a simplified and improved design. The TDR-1, an attack drone ahead of its time. Sometimes referred to as kamikaze drones or loitering munitions, armed UAVs are designed to purposely crash into their targets. They stand apart from other unmanned aerial vehicles due to their maneuverability and ability to linger over a target area before delivering their payload. Although often associated with the 21st century, their roots extend far into history. What stood out about the TDR-1 was its remarkably straightforward design. The aircraft featured a steel tube frame, a creation courtesy of the Schwinn Bicycle Company. The skeletal structure was ingeniously covered with a molded wood skin. This unusual choice of materials was no accident. It was a strategic decision to minimize the use of critical resources, ensuring that the production of higher priority aircraft remained unhindered. The pressed wood used for this purpose was supplied by an unlikely source, the Wurlitzer Musical Instrument Company, renowned for its pianos. As the TDR-1 took shape in September 1942, the U.S. Navy designated DeKalb, Illinois as the production hub for these remarkable drones. An airport sprang up on the city's eastern flank, a facility meticulously guarded around the clock. DeKalb's selection was strategic, for it was home to Wurlitzer, a company with a stellar reputation in wood product manufacturing. With a Navy contract in hand for 200 TDR-1s, Interstate Aircraft and Engineering Corporation, headquartered in El Segundo, California, undertook the assembly of these groundbreaking aircraft at the newly established DeKalb Airport. Approximately 190 of these drones were brought to life, rigorously tested, and carefully packaged for their journey. In the vast expanse of the South Pacific, these TDR-1 drones found their calling. The TDR-1 boasted impressive specifications. It measured 37 feet in length with a remarkable 48-foot wingspan, propelled by two Lycoming 0435 engines, generating 230 horsepower, granting it a top speed of 140 miles per hour. Its range extended up to 426 miles, and it could soar to altitudes of 6,000 feet. Designed primarily for ship-based combat, the TDR-1 featured three hardpoints, capable of carrying 2,000 pounds of ordnance. But what set this drone apart was its dual nature. Like its predecessor, the TDN-1, the TDR-1 featured a cockpit and flight controls, offering the option for human piloting during test flights. An aerodynamic fairing veiled the cockpit during operational missions, seamlessly transitioning between manned and unmanned modes. Control of the TDR-1 was a testament to the technological advancements of its era. These drones were piloted remotely, and the orchestration was sophisticated and meticulous. A conventional aircraft would serve as the commander, tracking the drone's every move. Upon release by a ground control crew, the TDR-1 would be handed over to a TBM pilot, often guided by a modified Grumman TBM-1C Avenger aircraft. The TBM pilot would establish a connection with the drone, subsequently relinquishing control to the operator in the rear cockpit. Herein lay the secret to the TDR-1's precision, a groundbreaking RCA television. A camera mounted in the drone's nose transmitted live images to a modest 5-inch screen in the Avenger's rear cockpit. Though the picture quality left much to be desired, it sufficed for the pilot's mission, a clear view of the target, particularly large vessels. The controller deftly maneuvered the drone, relying on the TDR's camera signals. With live footage displayed on the 5-inch screen, overlaid with vital data from a radar altimeter, the operator held the reins of this airborne warrior. Armed with bombs or torpedoes, the TDR-1 could unleash destruction in two ways: dropping its ordnance and returning home, or delivering a payload while directly targeting the enemy. Its fixed tricycle landing gear was a boon, discarded post-takeoff to enhance performance and extend its range for one-way missions. Initially, the U.S. Navy envisioned deploying up to 18 squadrons of assault drones under Project Option, ordering 162 Grumman TBF Avengers and 1,000 TDR-1s. However, technical challenges and a low-priority status led to a reduced order of approximately 300 aircraft. Once the TDR-1 had been developed and assembled, it found its way into the capable hands of three Special Task Air Groups, or STAGs. In 1942, the TDR-1 took its maiden flight, becoming fully operational within 2 years. By 1944, these pioneering drones had achieved operational readiness. They were entrusted to the capable STAG-1, leading the TDR-1 into combat in the South Pacific, where they would face off against the Japanese. In June 1944, STAG-1 was dispatched to the Solomon Islands, equipped with 50 TDR-1s for combat testing and their initial deployment. However, challenges quickly emerged in this tropical environment. The unforgiving climate and rudimentary infrastructure posed a significant challenge for the electrical equipment on board these drones. Nonetheless, ingenuity prevailed, and solutions were found to overcome these early setbacks. The TDR-1s were swiftly readied for action. On July 30th, the TDR-1 conducted its inaugural operational test. Four TDR-1s, each laden with a 2,000-pound bomb, soared from Benique Airfield to Cape Esperance on Guadalcanal. Their target, Yamazuki Maru, a grounded Japanese cargo vessel. Remarkably, the TDR-1s were managed from a distance of 7 miles away by a TBM Avenger control aircraft. As the stage was set for a daring display of drone warfare, control aircraft maintained a safe distance of approximately 7 miles away from the impending drama. The mission was straightforward. Each drone was to execute a direct assault on Yamazuki Maru, detonating on impact. The first drone struck its target, colliding with the ship's midsection, unleashing a cataclysmic explosion reverberating across the seascape. However, the second drone narrowly missed the ship's superstructure, instead crashing onto the island behind the vessel. The third drone, agonizingly close to its objective, fell just short of the ship's bow, failing to trigger its bomb. The fourth drone found its mark near the ship's rear, culminating in yet another colossal explosion. With two successful hits and two near misses, the U.S. Navy greenlit further operations against Japanese targets in the region. On September 27th, a quartet of TDR-1s embarked on the combat mission. Their objective was a Japanese vessel beached on Bougainville Island in the Solomons, fortified with Japanese defenses, including an anti-air battery. Each drone was armed with a mighty 2,000-pound bomb, and their journey spanned 55 miles to reach their destination. The outcome of this test was mixed. One drone was lost along the route, another came close to striking the ship but failed to detonate, and a third made contact but similarly did not explode. However, the fourth aircraft made history by slamming into the ship and successfully unleashing its immense explosive payload. This initial foray into combat was followed by a series of subsequent tests and flights conducted over the following month. Some missions ventured to targets located more than 100 miles from their base. Over the next month, Stag-1 launched a total of 46 TDR-1s. Their missions encompassed a diverse array of targets, including anti-aircraft emplacements, airfields, ships, bridges, and more. The price of these daring operations was significant, with 15 TDR-1s lost en route to their objectives, some of which were situated a staggering 160 miles away. While 31 hits were recorded, the precise number that resulted in the destruction of their intended targets remains shrouded in the annals of history. The TDR-1 drones carved a unique niche for themselves. They proved remarkably effective in targeting a multitude of military objectives. While several variants of the Interstate TDR program were conceived, only the TDR-1 reached production status. However, within the echelons of U.S. Navy leadership, a sense of disdain prevailed. Despite the drone's undeniable success, the assault drone program had already met its demise. The catalyst for this decision was not rooted in severe design flaws, but rather in politics, skepticism, and a dearth of familiarity with this groundbreaking technology. Not to mention, the deployment of the TDR-1 did not result in a single American life lost. Navy leaders, long harboring skepticism toward the drone, remained unimpressed by their accomplishments, advocating for more conventional systems instead. Consequently, the TDR-1 was withdrawn from active service by November 1944. Ultimately, the fate of the TDR-1 was sealed by a confluence of factors: ongoing technical challenges, unmet expectations, and the realization that traditional weaponry sufficed for Japan's defeat. By the time it received authorization for strike missions, the epicenter of heavy combat had shifted away from its area of operation, rendering its strikes relatively inconsequential to the broader war effort. During its operational tenure, approximately 50 drones were launched over 2 months, achieving 31 hits on targets that spanned anti-aircraft positions, bridges, airfields, and grounded ships. Nevertheless, the era's technological limitations constrained the TDR-1's targeting capabilities. The low-resolution camera mounted in its nose and the rudimentary television on the command plane posed challenges in accurately targeting moving objects, especially under the cover of night. The curtain fell on the TDR-1's wartime service on October 27th, having expended 50 drones on operations. Remarkably, the pilots of Stag-1 emerged unscathed, a testament to the innovative nature of the program. As the dust of World War II settled, some TDR-1s found a second lease on life, repurposed as private sports planes. The story of the TDR-1, the pioneering assault drone of its time, offers a fascinating glimpse into the evolution of combat drones. While modern armed UAVs showcase unprecedented sophistication, it's crucial to recognize the shining lights in the history of this technology, revealing its potential for future generations. The legacy of the TDR-1 lives on, with a single surviving example proudly displayed at the U.S. Navy's National Naval Aviation Museum in Pensacola, Florida. As enthusiasts and historians continue to preserve the past, various TDR parts find a new home at DeKalb Taylor Municipal Airport, where efforts to reconstruct another complete airframe for display are underway.